Good morning. I want to ask you a question, and you tell me what enters your mind. Okay, I'm going to say a word, and you tell me the first thing that enters your mind, you must speak out. Okay, for example, Toyota, you must say car. Okay, so Rolex, Starbucks, not bad. Gucci. Okay. Nike. Michael Jordan. Christian. That's the problem. When you say the word Christian, what enters your mind? You ask the people of the world, they have their ideas. For some people, Christian is a bad word. For some people, Christian is a good word. And this is where I want to share with you my heart, and hopefully this can bless you. Let's look at Matthew chapter 28. Can you see my PowerPoint here? So, can you now switch to my PowerPoint? All right. Everybody, if you don't mind, why don't we stand up and read this verse? This is, I'm sure all of you know this verse. Amen? If you don't know this verse, I do not know why you are here, okay? But I just like us to read this one more time. Everybody. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age." Now, before you sit down, let me ask you, what is the main verb of this church? Okay? What is the main verb of this verse? The primary verb. All right? Now, you have to raise your hand once. Okay? I'm going to ask questions. You must raise your hand at least once. How many of you say the main verb is go? Raise your hand. Go. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, 8. How many of you say the main verb is make disciples? Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you say the main verb is baptizing them? How many of you say the main verb is teaching them to observe? All right. Thank you. Please sit down. What is the main verb? Okay, a quick review. Everywhere I go, I ask this question. The main verb is make disciples, okay? The primary verb is make disciples, and going is what you call a verbal participle. It is supporting the main verb. You make disciples as you go. You make disciples as you baptize. You make disciples as you teach. So the main verb is make disciples. So turn to your neighbor, tell your neighbor, the main verb is make disciples. And let me tell you why this is so important. To make disciples means what? Can you whisper to your neighbor in your mind, what does it mean to make disciples? Just whisper, table by table. Okay. May I suggest, to make disciples is more than somebody coming to Christ. It is to help people become what? Followers of Jesus, to be Christ-like, right? A disciple is a student of Jesus. He follows Jesus and he becomes Christ-like. Why is this important? Let me share with you a story that happened years ago. There was an Asian. Maybe you know that story. He went to London to study law. And he was so enamored with Jesus. He was amazed at the teachings of Jesus. Because the teachings of Jesus is without parallel. Love your enemy. Pray for those who persecute you. So this guy is not a Christian, but he was so impressed with Jesus. He looked at his life. Amazing man. So when he finished his law degree in London, he went to South Africa to practice law. When he went to South Africa, he wanted to go to a church to study more about Jesus. When he entered the church, the leaders told him, "What are you doing?" He said, "I want to go to the church to attend service." And the leader said, "You cannot enter because you are a kafir." A kafir means you are colored. You are not white. He said, "But I like to know Jesus." They said, "Sorry. This is not for you." That young man decided from that day onward, Jesus is good, but Christianity is not for him. That man later on became one of the most famous men in India. His name was Mahatma Gandhi. And years later, a missionary went to see Gandhi and said, "What can we do to evangelize India?" And Gandhi said, "You tell Christians to act like Christ. And if they learn to act more like Christ, all of India will become Christian." And I submit to you, the problem is there is no discipleship. If the leaders of the South African church were discipled properly, I think they will be loving. But the problem is most of us do not really understand how to disciple people. I heard that the video is working. You like to see a short video? All right, let's show the video, please.
We live in a world of hatred, of violence, hopelessness, of hostility, where one-third of the people in the world have never even met a true follower of Christ. Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20 say, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you." CCF Beyond is helping us answer that call. We are partnering with Christians from different nations, backgrounds, cultures, and languages, equipping them to reach out to their own people, to share the gospel, make disciples, and multiply churches. By God's grace, CCF Beyond and its partners experienced a year of incredible growth in 2015. In South Asia, growth has been exponential. 1,700 leaders trained through CCF Beyond helped grow the ministry from 900 small groups in 2014 to 3,000 in 2015, from 3,100 house churches to 5,300. In East Asia, in a country influenced by ancient Buddhism and modern atheism, we have helped train over 150 leaders who have started over 600 small groups. In Nepal, our partners responded to the devastating earthquake and helped tens of thousands of school children hear the real story of Christmas. Discipleship helped catalyze a CCF satellite in Dubai, which grew from 20 D groups in 2014 to 75 in 2015. By God's grace, we have over 15 house churches and satellites from Abu Dhabi to LA to Sydney to Singapore to Qatar to Japan to Hawaii. The Great Commission is far from fulfilled. Jesus said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." Muslims are seeing visions of Jesus. Thousands of house churches are being planted among Hindus. Millions of Buddhists in China have turned to Christ. How will you respond this year? What more can you do? Will you too go beyond for Christ? Go, pray, send.
Praise God. Our burden is to help other churches, other Christians, understand how do you make disciples. So this morning, I want to share with you one of the most meaningful verses, if you ask me, the most beautiful verse, if you ask me, that you can use to teach people how to disciple people. Would you like to see that verse? It's found in the Old Testament. I want to share with you Ezra chapter 7, verse 10. If you don't mind, turn to your Bibles. Ezra chapter 7, verse 10. Ezra 7, verse 10 tells us, I think many of you know this. Let's read this together. Ezra set his heart to study the law of the Lord, to practice it, and to teach his statutes and ordinance in Israel. You notice something. Many of you are familiar with how do you disciple people? Well, Ezra set his heart to, number one, study. What's number two? Practice. What's number three? you teach. But to motivate people to follow these principles, many people forget the first word. What is the first word of Ezra 7, verse 10? For. Now, every time you see the word for, what enters your mind? See, that is a connective word. It's like a conjunction. It tells you the reason. Now, what is the reason for the word for? That means you look at the verse before. Now, what is the verse before verse 10? 9. Very good. Verse 9. So let's look at verse 9. Everybody? On the first day of the first month, he began to go up from Babylon. And on the first of the fifth month, he came to Jerusalem because, everybody read, because the good hand of his God was upon him. Now, because God's hand was upon him, how come God's hand was upon him? Because, everybody read, because Ezra set his heart. In other words, God's hand upon your life is really possible for all of us if you understand the principles of how do you allow God's hand to be in your life, in your ministry. Now, when the Bible uses the word God's hand, the idea is God's power in your life, through your life, and in your ministry. Now, I don't know about you, I need God's hand in our ministry, in my life. Do you need God's hand in your life? Do you want God's hand in your ministry? What does it mean? So today, I want to leave you with this idea. Everybody read this together. God's hand in your life. One more time. God's hand in your life. Meaning, you want God's hand in your ministry. You want God's hand in your family. You want God's hand in your discipleship. We want God's hand. We want God's power. We want God's help. We want God's blessing. Yes or no? Of course. Now, what does it mean, God's hand, in your life? Let's look at the context of Ezra 7 and how that word is used. For example, God's hand in your life. God's power, God's blessing. Let's read this together. Ezra went up from Babylon, and he was a scribe skilled in the law of Moses, which the Lord God of Israel had given him. The king granted him all he requested because, everybody, because the hand of the Lord, his God, was upon him. Meaning, you and I, many times, we need permission. We need approval. You need to learn to work with leaders. And many times, we cannot do it apart from God's power in what he wants you to do. Amen? So, the idea of God's hand in your life, it's really a beautiful word because it means God is working in you, through you. Another word of God's hand in your life. Everybody, let's read this together. I, King Artaxerxes, issue a decree to all the treasurers who are in the province beyond the river. Whatever, notice, everybody read, whatever Ezra the priest, the scribe of the law of the God of heaven, may require of you, what must you do? It shall be done diligently. In other words, God can use a pagan king to help Ezra become successful in his mission because God's hand is upon him. You see, you and I need supernatural power, supernatural strength in our ministry. What God has given us is impossible to accomplish. Make disciples of all nations, that's hard. I need God to open doors. God's hand means in your life, my life, he opens what? Doors. He can close, he can open. Let's read this together. You know what? By the way, do you need money? Almost all mission agency, they need provision. Yes or no? Well, make sure God's hand is in your ministry. I want to tell you stories later on. King Artaxerxes issued a decree to all the treasurers. Do you know Ezra was financed by the treasury of the king? God owns everything. Yes or no? Yes. He owns everything. Yes. And you need money? I need money. My friend, make sure God's hand is in your ministry. I remember what Hudson Taylor said. God's work done God's way will never lack God's resources. I really believe God speaks to us through His resources many times. Let's look at this one. The good hand of our God upon us, they brought us a man of insight of the sons of Mali, the son of Levi, the son of Israel, namely Sherebiah and his sons and brothers, 18 men. Do you need people? Do you need a team in your ministry? You know, people always tell me, we don't have manpower, we lack workers. Well, you want God's hand in your ministry. You know why? God can help you, what? Bring the right team members. Ezra, because of God's hand upon him, God brought people to help him. I really believe our work is supernatural. So, my priority is to really ask God to give us the right people. Provide the resources. Another word for God's hand in your life. How is that used? By the way, do you need protection? How many of you work in dangerous areas? Raise your hand. Dangerous area. Well, our ministry, because our passion is the third world countries, so many times it's dangerous area, and we always need protection. Well, look at God's hand in your life. Let's read this together. I was ashamed to request from the king troops and horsemen to protect us from the enemy of the way. On the way, because we had said to the king, the hand of our God is favorably disposed to all those who seek him. And you know what? Ezra understood the importance of God's hand. So we fasted and sought our God concerning this matter. So it's important you learn to fast and pray. You want God's hand in your life. And the Bible tells us, we journeyed from the river Ahava on the 12th of the first month to go to Jerusalem. Do you know, by the way, do you know how far is Babylon to Jerusalem? Anybody has any idea? The distance you need to travel, not a straight line, but based on the route, based on the routing, it's 900 miles, more or less. It's like from here to go to Hong Kong. It's not easy. You need God's hand. You need God's protection. You need God's provision. And the Bible tells us, the hand of our God was over us, and he delivered us from the hand of the enemy. So my point is this. You and I, we need God's hand. Now, how do you make sure God's hand is in your life, in your ministry? Would you like to know that? Well, let me show you a New Testament verse, the importance of God's hand. In the early church, God's hand was on their ministry. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. In other words, you and I need God's hand in our ministry. I cannot convert people, but God can. I cannot change people, God can. Amen? Now, how do you do it? All right? How do you do this? Well, let's study the principles. Ezra set his heart to do three things. Number one, everybody, study. Number two, practice. And number three, teach. Because of what he did, God's hand was upon his life. So there are certain principles you and I need to understand. If you want God's power, God's hand in your ministry. I call this discipleship. How do I disciple people? I teach them to study God's word. I help them practice it. And then I encourage them to repeat what they're learning to teach others. So what does it mean? Well, first, the heart. You know, the heart is most important. Ezra set his heart. I have a friend. He is a pastor of a very big church in Atlanta. And the first time I met him, he showed me a compass. I said, what is this compass? He said, Peter, everywhere I go, I have a compass. Now, how many of you know what is a compass? Raise your hand. Now, today, you know, you use GPS, right? But during my days, compass. Now, compass is for direction. And I said, why do you need a compass? He said, very simple, Peter. When I'm in the hotel room, I have a picture of my family, my wife, and a compass. When I travel to another country, I have a compass and the picture of my family. I said, what does it mean? He said, I remind myself, compass sets direction. The direction of your life is important. And I'm not about to do anything that will jeopardize my family, my ministry. When I'm tempted to do something wrong, I look at the compass. My compass should always be moving toward the Lord. I met him again 2 years ago in one of our conferences in the Philippines. And I told him to share with our pastors. He showed us his compass again. So this guy has compass all over the place because direction determines destination. Now, I do not know about your heart. I do not know how your heart is doing today. But I like to pray that all leaders, your heart is really set to please God. Because sometimes ministry can go off track if the heart is not right. If the heart of the leader becomes himself, if the heart of the leader becomes the ministry becomes more important than love, ministry becomes more important than Jesus, I think we have a problem. So the heart is crucial. The Bible tells us to watch your heart with all diligence. Okay, so it is very important. So this is a compass. If you don't know a compass, I'm showing you a compass. So what must you do with your heart? Number one, you make sure you study. Everybody say it with me. Study. I have discovered many leaders stop growing because they stop studying. So I tell our pastors, I tell our leaders, when was the last time you read a book? You see, leaders, you and I, must keep studying. We must keep growing. The day we stop growing, we stop leading. So my encouragement to all of us, when you disciple people, you model yourself by what? Studying. Now, when I study not only the scripture. I study the lives of people. I study what's going on. And that's why I praise God for this mission conference. You learn from others. You learn what others are doing. You learn. You can adjust. But always study. Amen? Right. Number two, what else did he do? Well, the Bible tells us he practiced. Now, let me ask you, what is easier, to study or to practice? Study is easier. Practice is a lot harder. Huh? Because it's one thing to know, it's another thing to practice. You know, I need to practice loving my wife. I love my wife, but I need to practice. Because it's one thing to know, it's another thing to practice. Do you recall years ago, many people don't realize I'm a businessman. In fact, if they introduce me, sometimes I like them to know. Just introduce me as a simple businessman who loves the Lord and who disciples people. You see, years ago, during martial law, my father used to own the largest textile mill in the Philippines at that time, almost in Asia. We have 7,000 employees. So we have big, big operations. And the government, the relative of the president, did not exactly got into good terms with us. Would you believe it? I was kicked out of our own company. How can you be kicked out of your own company? Very simple. In the Philippines, nothing is impossible. Now, God did a miracle. You know why? Because there was a people's revolution. Remember? Revolution. And the relative of the dictator got sick. And he needed help. He needed prayer. Because the sickness was very serious. He was dying. And my friend called me, Peter. He wants you to talk to him. He wants you to pray for him. Now, in my mind, why would I pray for this man who kicked me out of our company? What if he gets well? What if he goes to heaven? So I said, I've forgiven him, but I don't want to talk to him. But the Lord spoke to me. The Lord said, you practice. See, the Lord told me, you are discipling people. If you don't obey, if you don't live out what you know, how can you disciple people? So I said, okay, Lord. So I went to see him. I remember, it's in Green Hills. His house is somewhere here. And when I knocked at the door, I was hoping, you know, he doesn't want to see me. I was hoping, he cannot talk. But you know what? The wife opened the door. The wife said, oh, welcome. And the moment I entered the house and opened the bedroom, something happened. My love for him just grew. I felt sorry for this man. And I realized the importance of practice. You got to practice what you know. You see, the Bible is given, make disciples, teach them to observe what? All. Today, I'm sad. When I hear Christians, even in the Philippines, we have Christian leaders suing each other. I mean, this is crazy. When you have leaders who do not know how to practice love, it makes me cry. It makes me sad. When I hear leaders divorcing, I said, what in the world? Oh, why? You know why? We don't practice. Last, what must you do? Not only practice. The Bible tells us, you must teach them to teach. So you study. Next, what must you do? Practice. And then you teach. It's hard. You know, you can teach. But really, to disciple people, it's life to life. It's one thing to teach intellectually, but to teach from the heart is another thing. That's why I want to remind all of us, our calling is what, everybody? Read one more time. Go therefore what? Make disciples, okay? So that's the calling. Not just proclaim the gospel, but make disciples. In CCF, we tell our pastors, our leaders, whatever you do to share the gospel, it is always best to have a follow-up system. What do you do with the people who raise their hands? What do you do with people who receive Christ? Well, the Bible tells us we are going to make disciples. So what do? We baptize them. We incorporate them in a small group. We teach them to what? Notice, you teach them to, please read, to observe. What else? Observe all. And that, my friend, is the clearest example of what it means to be a disciple. You teach somebody to follow the Lord and to obey. So what we do, we start with ourselves, then we start with the family, and then we go over the friends, and then your co-workers. So it is a circle that keeps expanding and expanding. And that is what we simply do. We have many business people, we have many professionals, and that's what we do. And by the grace of God, let me give you a short history of CCF, okay? We started in a house. It's a home Bible study. Three families. My wife and I were the believer, and the two other families are not believers. They came to Christ, so we moved to their house. They invited their friends, and their friends invited their friends, and we began to grow. So we went to Green Hills in a garage. It was more people coming to Christ. Then more people came. Then we went to a school, the Asian Institute of AIM. That was our first worship service in 1984. So we grew. From AIM, because people are discipling people, we grew. Then we moved to the theater. Do you remember Greenbelt Theater? Okay, so it's a theater. And then from that theater, we grew and grew. And we decided to go to PICC, Philippine International Convention Center, Plenary Hall. And then we grew. We outgrew it. So we divided. So one went to Valle Verde Country Club, and the other one is in Sukat. We grew. And then God touched the heart of a businessman who is not from CCF. He donated the building to CCF. Remember God's hand in your life? When God's hand is in your ministry, He provides. Well, He donated the building for us in Alabang. And that is what He donated in Alabang. And we only paid 1 peso a year. Very expensive. Because it's God's provision. And then God touched the heart of another businessman who is not from CCF. He built us a place that can sit 3,500 people, and he charged us 1 peso a year. So that is St. Francis Square. So we moved there. We had 6 services in this place. And God said, you know, we were contented. So during our anniversary, we would meet in Araneta Coliseum. This was years ago. 1 in the morning, 1 at night. We were outgrowing the place because people were discipling people. No secret. You just teach people to obey, then to teach others. That's how you grow. But then God did something. God wanted us to wake up, not to be too lazy, too easy. So the owner decided to kick us out. He said, you know what? This place, you have to live. You know, I got a shock of my life. My God, how can we live? So God opened our eyes, and He said, it's about time you put up your own center. So by the grace of God, hopefully you have time to visit our new center. We went to a place near here, I think it's only 2-3 kilometers away. That place is never for sale because all the buildings there is on lease. But I prayed to the Lord. I said, Lord, tell the owner to sell to us. And you know what? They sold it to us 10 years to pay. And then we paid it in 1 year. Is God amazing? Amazing. Today they are scratching their head. They said, why did we sell it to CCF? Sorry, because all the buildings there are all on lease, except our building. So this is our new headquarters. It's the new CCF Center. Hopefully you can visit us. And our first worship service is in 2013. And God gave us a wonderful place. You know why? God's hand in your life. Now, this is supernatural. This building costs a lot of money. Millions of dollars. However, when we move in, we had no debt because of God's hand in our midst. So, this is God's example of God's hand in your ministry. Just last week, I saw an example of God's hand in our ministry. We inaugurated a CCF satellite in Isabela. That's the governor, and these are the leaders that we had. Would you believe it? Do you like to know the story of CCF Kawayan? Can I tell you the story here? God's hand in your ministry. This building was offered to us 3 years ago. The board said, it's too expensive. We are not going to invest in that. And the people are not big enough to take care of that facilities. Would you believe it? God touched the heart of a businessman who is not from CCF, who is not even a Christian, to buy that building. Because the owner is from CCF, but he had financial problem. And he put up a sign for sale. When the guy bought the property, who is not a Christian, who is not even from CCF, after buying the building, you know what he said? He turned around, I'm going to give this to CCF 1 peso a year. Is God amazing? I have all of these stories of 1 peso a year, okay? It is God. So last Sunday, we had our first service in Isabela. Is God amazing? My friend, I give this glory to the Lord. It's not us. I mean, we are not, you know, we are not good looking or what. We just follow the Lord. You know what you do? Study, practice, teach. Meaning you make disciples to make disciples. So as we close, I want you to know, our mission is very simple. Everybody, I want to share with you our mission. What's our mission? To honor God and make Christ committed followers. Who will make Christ committed followers? That's what we do. And by the grace of God, we have grown all over Metro Manila. Our satellites, we just keep growing, okay? As of today, I don't even know how many we are now. I think it's over, but it's God's grace. So we are in North Luzon. We are also in Bicol region. We are expanding now in Mindanao. And these are examples of our satellites. They are not small. The one in Alabang is over 3,000 people. They just keep growing. I mean, we start small, but they just keep growing. So they grow, Trias, Tagaytay. These are just samples, okay? CCF Cebu, Davao. Our Davao is almost 2,000 people. Our Cebu is almost 2,000 people. They just keep growing, and they're planting. They're planting all over the place. And then we have international. We're planting all over the place. We have many house churches. We don't even call them CCF. When you go to some parts of Asia, you will not see the word CCF. We don't care about CCF. We just want to help people. And then we plant with them. We finance the training, everything. For example, you have Singapore. You have Dubai. These are examples. You have Qatar. You have East Asia. You know, this is some places in Southeast Asia. So by the grace of God, let me just close with a true story of Coca-Cola. How many of you have heard of Coca-Cola? Okay, you know why you have heard of Coca-Cola? Because in 1923, there was a guy by the name of Robert Woodruff. He became the president of Coca-Cola, and he had a vision. His vision is a Coke within arm's reach of desire. That's his vision. Robert Woodruff pursued his vision. In less than 100 years, Coca-Cola fulfilled its vision. Coca-Cola is all over the world, over 200 countries. It was the first multinational company to set up a soft drink company in China. Less than 100 years, it fulfilled its vision worldwide. Our commander-in-chief gave us the same mission and vision worldwide 2,000 years ago. But to this day, we have not fulfilled his mission. It's already 2,000 years. But the gospel, we don't make disciples all over the world. What's the problem? The problem is we are not making disciples. We do not follow the simple plan of Jesus, which is make disciples. How do you make disciples? Teach them to study God's word. You practice and you teach. It's called multiplication. God bless you.